Today's June 4th, and our group today is Cole, Dominic, and Sarah. We're doing the specific heat of a metal lab, and here we've got some lead, and here's our calorimeter.
Standing to get to room temperature.
Yeah, and the process, or the goal of the lab today is to determine the specific heat of a substance, and we'll need a utility clamp, we'll need our calorimeter, we'll need lead, distilled water, and an unknown metal, and we're going to need a thermometer, and we're going to be heating three different types of metals.
Here we have all three different cups. We've got our styrofoam cup on the furthest left, and that'll be the thing that the liquid's in. We've got our second styrofoam cup for insulation and tin foil around it, and our third cup that'll hold the other two cups.
So here we have our three cups inside each other and inside the two bowls, which have packaging peanuts inside of them to look kind of like a flying saucer. And our lid was made out of two of the bottoms of two different bowls with some of the foam padding. So that's three layers of insulation, and it fits snugly on the top of the cups. And Salvo is also, as you can see right now, putting on some caulk to seal the opening between the cups and the bowls.
So here we're putting the stirring rod and the thermometer into the top of the calorimeter, which was two layers. And we also had some clay that you can't really see wrapping around the, oh, you can see it better there, to try and keep some more of that heat in. And that puffball that looks like a hat is also there to keep some of the heat in from the stirring rod.
So you can see that our finished product looks like a bug. We've got little red wings on the back, and you can see the googly eyes on the front. The stirring rod and the thermometer look like antennas, and that is where the water will go into inside the cups. And then you have some arms and legs as well coming off the side. And our lid, the insulating cotton ball, also looks like hair for our little guy.
So here we've got some lead shot that's boiling in a beaker. Once the lead shot boils, we're going to pour it into our calorimeter. And we're going to test the specific heat of lead by taking the temperature that the room temperature water changes after we pour the lead into the water. And that, with some calculations, we should get our specific heat of lead.
Here we are heating our second lead shot up to boiling point and then later we will be putting it into the calorimeter to check the specific heat of this particular lead shot and our calorimeter.
And now we're measuring the second sample of lead shot in our calorimeter.
So now we're starting our unknown metal. We've got a larger beaker because we have the metal slightly, or it's a lot larger this time. We're heating it now, and it's taking a long, long time.
We are still measuring the heat to try to get it to boiling.
So now we have the mystery metal and the water finally starts boiling, so we are turning off the flame underneath it, which is keeping the water boiling. And we are going to dump the hot water in the sink and pour the mystery metal into the calorimeter to check the specific heat of it.
Now we're starting reaction number lab number two. We've got three reactions today. The purpose is to measure the heat of a reaction for three related exothermic reactions and to verify Hess's law of heat summation. And we're going to need lots of pretty dangerous chemicals like 0.5 molar hydrochloric acid, 1 molar hydrochloric acid, and 1 molar sodium hydroxide. And it's like a reaction. Our first part, we're seeing NaOH and water. Second part, we're missing NaOH and I think hydrochloric acid. And third part, we're missing.
So here's our first reaction. It's actually a reaction of dissolution. We have sodium hydroxide pellets dissolving into water.
So here we are retrieving 100 milliliters of 1 molar hydrochloric acid. So now we're doing the same thing as reaction one, except for we're using hydrochloric acid. So this reaction is both dissolution and reaction heat, and we're measuring that in our calorimeter.
So here we have the sodium hydroxide pellets, which were in the hydrochloric acid, and as you can see, they basically just look like water, or it looks like nothing, everything dissolved. You can't tell that anything was really in there besides just normal water.
So now we're doing our third reaction, and it's a legitimate reaction this time because we have two sets of liquids. We've got 50 milliliters of hydrochloric acid and 50 milliliters of sodium hydroxide, and they'll react, which will release heat in the calorimeter, which we're going to measure.
Specific heat of metal, and it asks to determine the changes in temperature of the water and the lead shot. So to get the change in the water temperature, you use Q equals 100 grams times the specific heat of water, which is 4.18 joules over grams times degrees Celsius times the delta T, which would, it went from 25.5 degrees to 27.5 degrees, so that's 2 degrees Celsius. You can cross out grams and degrees Celsius, and then when you calculate that, you get Q equals 836
joules.
And then you plug this in to get the specific heat for the lead, which is what we're trying to find. So you can say, since it's opposite, you say negative 836 joules equals 93.9 was the mass of the lead times C, which is, stands for the specific heat, times negative 62.5, which is the temperature change for the lead. And when you calculate that out, you get C equals 0.142. So that's the first trial we did. The trial number two was pretty similar. We got Q equals, actually it was exactly the same for the water part. So then you would plug in negative 836 for Q. The thing that was different about the water part was that it was from 25 to 27 instead of 25.5 to 27.5. And then Q equals 93.9 again times C, because that's what we're trying to solve for, times, and then this time it was from 90.5 to 27 degrees, so it was negative 63.5 degrees Celsius. And it all crosses it out again, and so you get C equals 0.140 joules over grams degrees Celsius.
Now we will add the specific heats of the two lead that we got, so, and find the average of it. So we have 0.142 joules per gram degrees Celsius over under
plus
and then we find the, we add them together and
0.282.
That equals 0.282 joules degrees Celsius, and then and then we divide that by 2,
0.141,
and that equals 0.141 joules grams degrees Celsius.
So now we're calculating the specific heat of an unknown metal, and so we have our water equation, which is 100 grams times the specific heat of water times the temperature change of water, and that gives us 1,797.4 joules. So we plug that back in, and then this is our mass around my metal. We're looking for the specific heat, and then this is the temperature change, and that gets us 0.393 joules over degrees or grams degrees Celsius. So here we have, we're calculating our percent error for a mass of lead, or specific heat of lead. We got 0.141 joules minus, our given is 0.128, over 0.128 times 100, and that gives us 10% error.
Okay, so for finding the change in temperature, all you have to do is subtract the initial temperature from the highest temperature. So for reaction one, the highest temperature we ever reached was 25 degrees. And we started at 19 degrees, so that's 6 degrees change. And then for reaction two, we got to 31 degrees at the end, and we started with 22 degrees, and so that is obviously 9 degrees. And then, we started one of the hydrochloric acid started at 21 degrees, and the sodium hydroxide started at 20 degrees, so we said 20.5. And we got to 27, so 6.5 degrees was the temperature change for that one.
So here we have 100 grams of H2O
and we add that to 2.08 grams of sodium hydroxide, and we get 102.08 grams of H2O plus NaOH. And that is reaction number one. Here's reaction number two. We have 100 grams of hydrochloric acid. We add that to 2.01 grams of NaOH, giving us 102.0 grams of hydrochloric acid plus sodium hydroxide. And then we have, for the third reaction, we have 50 grams of hydrochloric acid plus 50 grams of sodium hydroxide, and we get 100 grams of hydrochloric acid plus sodium hydroxide.
So now we're calculating the different heat reaction, and for number one, we got Q equals 102.08 plus, or times 4.18 times 6 degrees, and that equals 2,560 joules. For number reaction number two, we have 102.01 grams times 4.18, the specific heat of Earth.
Yeah.
Heat times 90 degrees, which is the change in temperature, and Q equals 3,837 joules. And for reaction number three, Q equals 100 grams times 4.18 times 6.5 degrees. And Q equals 2,717 joules.
Okay, really quick, what does each one of the inputs stand for?
Well, here we got the grams, the total mass, and then we got the specific heat of water, and this is our change in temperature, and this is, would be the heat of our reaction.
Word. To find the number of moles of sodium hydroxide used, we're going to use a conversion equation method. Factor. So you have, for the first one, we got 2.08 grams of NaOH times one mole, and the molar mass of sodium hydroxide is 40 grams. So that ends up being 0.052 moles. So then for the second one, it's pretty similar, but we had 2.01 grams of sodium hydroxide times one mole over 40 grams again. And this one was 0.05 moles. So the moles for the third reaction of sodium hydroxide were actually done for us, and it also was 0.05 moles.
Reaction one, we're finding the energy release per mole of NaOH for each reaction, and we've got 2,560 joules of released heat over 0.052 moles consumed, and that gives us 49,230.8 joules over a mole. And then for reaction two, we got 3,837.6 joules over 0.05 mole, and that gives us 752 joules over a mole. And then for number three, we've got 2,717 joules over 0.05 mole, and that gives us 54,340 joules over a mole.
So, because of the additive nature of each of the reactions, number
reaction one
should, plus reaction two should equal reaction three.
Do we go?
Because of the additive nature of each of a reaction, reaction one plus reaction three should equal reaction two. And but we had around 10% error. So this is what we got for energy for reaction one, this is what we got for reaction three, and this is what we got for reaction two.
And they kind of sort of add, but we have a percent error, so it's not perfect.
So here we have heat one plus heat three, and it's all times one. And we, once we get that, we subtract it by heat 2, and that's all over heat 2. And we got 30.349, so you multiply that by 100, and our percent error was 34.9% error.
So number 10 asks, would changing the amount of sodium hydroxide used in reaction 1 affect the value obtained for the energy given off per mole of sodium hydroxide? We had two different amounts for reactions 1 and 2. We had 2.08 grams of sodium hydroxide and then 2.01 in the second one. And the one with 2.08 had a higher amount of energy per mole. So we know that if you raise the number, the mass or amount of grams of NaOH, you're gonna get a higher amount of energy per mole.
Ready? State in your own words what is meant by the additive nature of heats of reaction. So in reaction one, we had solid NaOH and water, and that was a dissolution. And in reaction three, we had two liquids, hydrochloric acid and NaOH, and that was a reaction. And we had in reaction two, solid NaOH and liquid hydrochloric acid, so it was dissolution and a reaction. So dissolution number one and reaction three combined to make dissolution and reaction in reaction two.
You're going.
Let's get a little taking into account your answer to problem four, explain why you were asked to use exactly 2 grams of NaOH in reaction 1 and 2, an equivalent number of moles in NaOH in reaction 3. So, in this question, the amount of NaOH we used was how much energy would be produced, so we had to have an exact number of NaOH.
Okay, so what do you guys think could have been our sources of error?
Well, I believe, Sarah and Cole, that one error we could have had is heat could have escaped through errors that we had while making the calorimeter.
I think another one could have been when we pulled our lead and our unknown metal out of the boiling water. Heat could have escaped there.
Yeah, we might also have not had a perfect thermometer working or something.
All the thermometers' fault.
Do you think that specific heat can be used to identify unknown metals?
Yes, because if you have a specific heat, you can just go home and look it up, or the specific heat of your unknown metal, right?
That is, if your calorimeter is precise enough.
And then you can try to match it with the specific heat that you calculated.
It's like what we were doing to find the unknown metal, except it'll be hard for us.
Possibly might not work for us. We had a large percent error.
What would you guys think worked on our calorimeter, and what do you think didn't work?
Pretty much everything Sarah did didn't work. I'm just kidding. I think that if we would have crushed up the packing peanuts and put them in the bowl around, maybe that would have kept the heat in, or if we had another thin layer of maybe the sleeping pad going around the cups and then put that in the bowl, I think that would have helped.
Yeah, or more of a better fitting lid. I feel like there could have still been some little bit of heat that escaped through the lid.
Yeah, I think also our stirring rod took off a lot of the styrofoam on the inside, which probably let stuff escape.
Even though we did our best to make it not that choke.
Yep.
Fantastic.